A woman in a park ranger uniform stands in front of a trailhead sign in the woods. It's snowing lightly.
Hello, it's Ranger Melissa. Happy Glacier Science Day. We are here today to learn all about black and grizzly bears. We are going to have such a great science video because we're meeting up with wildlife bear biologist John Waller, who has a PhD from the University of Montana. He, go Grizz. And he has worked in Glacier National Park for 18 years as a wildlife biologist with a focus on carnivores. So he's done a lot of amazing research and been in the park for many years and knows this place very well. So we're gonna meet up with him to talk about grizzly and black bears, and he's gonna show us signs that they've been here. So stick with us and we'll learn a lot more about that in just a minute. But first I wanna say we're here at the Autumn Creek Trailhead, which is just off of Highway 2 near Marias Pass. It's not warm today, but it's not super cold. It's probably in the 40s and partly cloudy. So we're looking at bundling up here in probably just a minute and heading down the trail. All right, come on, let's go. Let's go find John.
Melissa walks down a forested trail with patches of snow towards a man in a park ranger uniform.
All right, let's see. Oh, there's John. Hey, John, how are you?
Good. How are you, Melissa?
Hey, thanks for meeting us here for Glacier Science Day.
Sure,
we're so
my pleasure.
Excited that you're here today. We're going to learn all about bears in Glacier National Park. And I know that you had some things on this Autumn Creek Trail that you wanted to show us today. So is there anything right here that you found?
Well, it's funny you should ask because it just so happens there's a rub tree right behind me,
oh,
right here.
Perfect. Nice. Okay. Well, how do you know that?
Melissa and John go to examine a small tree on the side of the trail.
Well, you can see it's all gnarly and chewed up and ripped up here where the bears have been raking it with their claws and biting it with their teeth. And if you come around to this other side, you can actually see the claw marks on the side of the tree here.
Oh, wow. Look at that.
Close-up of long claw mark and tree trunk. As John talks to Melissa, images captured by wildlife trail cameras are shown of brown and black bears rubbing their backs on trees.
And why do they do that?
Well, it's a scent marking behavior. We don't know exactly sure, but we think it's a sort of a territorial marking behavior that they do.
So this is my area, keep out?
Yeah, and sometimes I think their backs just itch, so it feels good.
Yeah,
too.
Sure.
John's discussion of how bears climb is illustrated by photographs of both black and grizzly bears climbing trees.
If you've ever watched a black bear climb a tree, they actually, they'll use their jaws to help them climb.
Oh.
So they'll actually bite the bark of the tree. Like sometimes big cottonwoods have really thick bark.
Yeah.
And they can grab the bark with their teeth and then lunge up with both paws. And so they'll bite and kind of go up like that.
Oh, wow, I didn't know that. And that's specific to black bears, you said?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm thinking you guys shouldn't try that at home, because your teeth are gonna fall out. That is great that a bear's teeth are that strong.
Yeah, and grizzly bears can climb too. Some people think grizzlies can't climb trees. They're perfectly adept at climbing trees. They just don't have to because they're grizzly bears.
They're the top of the line, right?
Yeah, who's gonna make them climb a tree?
Nobody, not me.
John stands by a larger tree trunk.
Hey, Melissa, come look at this.
What do you got?
It's another rub tree, and this one's got hair stuck
all over. Ooh, I want to see that. Can I get around you?
Yeah. See that little fuzz right there?
Close-up of a clump of fuzzy light brown hair stuck to sap on tree trunk.
Wow, that's cool.
Hair is really important to bears because it keeps them warm.
Yeah, I would assume.
But it also, when they rub, it sticks to the sap on the tree.
Trail camera photo of large grizzly bear squatting down to rub its back against a tree.
And what's neat about hair is if you can pull the hair off and get the root of the hair, you can identify individual bears by the DNA in their hair follicle.
Wow, that is, so individual bears can be identified just from a strand of hair.
Yep, and that turned out to be a powerful research tool because back in 2004, Kate Kendall, who was with the U.S. Geological Survey at the time.
Photo of woman collecting bear hair caught in a barbed wire snag on a tree trunk.
Used that method, going around and collecting hair off of rub trees to actually estimate the population of bears in the park.
Yeah, and so just by looking at rub trees, or was there another way that they collected the hair?
Well, they also put out barbed wire hair snag enclosures with the bait, but by using both methods, they made the total project much more powerful.
Photos show researchers setting up barbed wire enclosures and a trail camera photo of a bear inside the enclosure area.
Really good population estimate for the whole Northern Continental Divide ecosystem. So it's really quite an impressive tool.
Do you remember how many grizzly bears were in Glacier?
Well, they didn't look at glaciers by itself because Glacier's part of the bigger ecosystem. We're only about 2 miles from the park boundary right here.
Okay.
And so a bear that is rubbing on this tree can easily run across the boundary and rub on a tree out there. So it makes more sense to look at the broader area.
Yes.
But she estimated in that broader area, which was about an 8 million acre area, there
were
765 grizzly bears at that time.
Okay, and that was in the 90s?
That was in 2004.
2004, okay.
Close up of a faint bear track in the mud, John uses a stick to outline the shape of the track, accompanied by photos of a grizzly track contrasted with a black bear track.
So sometimes bear tracks can be hard to see when the ground's hard, but if you look close, you can see a bear track right here. This is a front track. So this is his palm right there. And then you can see the toes right here, like that. In the snow. And I can tell this is a grizzly because there's a straight line between the pad and the toes. So if you can draw a straight line without touching the pad or the toes, you know it's a grizzly bear. And typically, sometimes you can see imprints from the claws that stick way out in front of the toe. So usually they're a couple inches out in front of the toe on a grizzly bear. Black bear, the claws will be tucked in close to the toe because they curve in. So if we look back, you can see some more back here. Here's another one here. You can see that big space between the pad and the toes. There, and a little imprint from a claw right there.
John and Melissa are walking down the trail. John stops to point out a large hole in the ground.
All right.
Oh, Melissa, you walked past this hole.
Yes, I saw the hole. Am I supposed to do something?
That's a bear hole. That's
what?
A grizzly digging right there.
A grizzly did that?
A grizzly did that.
No way. Oh
so
my gosh.
Picture in your mind a grizzly bear. What do you think of?
Just those claws?
Those claws and that big shoulder hump. That's what they do. They call them nature's rototiller.
Yeah.
And this is why, because they spend a lot of time just digging, looking for roots and corms down in the soil.
Close-up photo of a grizzly bear's outstretched limbs with long claws. Photo of a grizzly bear digging in snowy ground, its snout covered with dirt.
These kind of dry, south-facing aspects, a lot of times you'll find biscuit root.
Photos of a plant with yellow flowers and long tuber-like roots.
And it's got a big root, like a starchy, almost like a potato.
Oh, yeah. Oh,
and
yum.
They'll dig those out and eat them. And so they're always looking. So when a bear's traveling along a trail like this, they'll see a biscuit root and they'll stop and dig the roots out.
Melissa and John face each other in a clearing with snowy mountains behind.
So, John, I've just always kind of been curious. Like, you know, you think about those big, huge brown bears in Alaska, which I know are the same as grizzly bears. It's just like here and the same species. But you think of like them eating all the salmon and they're huge and they kind of just rumble around.
Shot of grizzly bear in Alaska eating salmon, followed by shot of grizzly bear in Glacier wandering through meadow.
And I feel like the bears here, when I'm here, just have kind of a whole different environment and a whole different way of living. Is there any similarities or differences, or is it pretty much all grizzly bears are the same?
Yeah, they're all the same. Grizzly bears are neat because they have the capacity to grow as long as the food supply will support that growth.
Okay.
So the bears in coastal Alaska get really big because they have this super abundant, super rich food source to use to put towards growth.
Photo of extremely large grizzly bear in Katmai National Park, Alaska.
And so they can go over 1,000 pounds up to 1,500 pounds. Northwest Montana is really a berry-based economy. We have this huge wealth of berries, and they can get quite large eating berries.
Close-up of huckleberry plant.
But really, to get big, you need meat. So sometimes, particularly on the east side of the divide where we have a much bigger elk population, bears can get quite a bit bigger because they have that protein source. So occasionally we see bears that'll hit 1,000 pounds here.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Clip of huge grizzly bear on trail with caption, footage courtesy Bob Chinn, followed by clip of smaller grizzly roaming through a meadow.
But on the west side of the divide where they're eating primarily berries, a typical big male is much more likely to be around 600 pounds.
Okay.
John points out a pile of bear scat on the trail and uses a stick to dig through it.
So this is a bear poop. It's on the trail. It's got some snow on it because it snowed last night. But if we kind of poke around in there, we can find all kinds of interesting things. Oh, it looks like mountain ash berries.
Photos of a plant with bright red-orange berries and a black bear eating them.
A little huckleberry leaf there. Well, you can see it's mostly vegetation. So you could say that this bear is eating primarily berries.
John talks to the camera with shots overlaid of black and brown bears eating from shrubs.
Like I said, bears are opportunistic omnivores. They'll eat just about anything. But if you've noticed in the background here, we have a lot of snow. So it's fall now. It's getting cold. They're talking about temperatures in the single digits next week. So all the plants are dried out and frozen. All the berries are starting to drop off. So there's really not much for bears to eat. So what do? Bears are really cool because they hibernate over the winter. So when the food runs out, they go and dig themselves a den in the ground and they sleep in there for up to 6 months.
Photo from inside den of black bear curled up with a tiny cub.
And it's really cool because they stay in there and don't come out. They don't eat, they don't drink, they don't defecate, or they don't urinate for that whole time. So it's really quite an amazing physiological adaptation to a harsh winter climate that they've developed.
Melissa and John stand together.
So, gosh, John, I remember the first time I came to Glacier National Park. It was a while ago. But I came, and the first hike I did was Grinnell Glacier. But this was like mid-October.
Photo of remote mountain trail.
And it was just me and my partner at the time. And we hiked up there, and he was kind of walking up a knoll, I turned around and saw this massive grizzly bear. And it was just digging like crazy. You could see its hump moving.
Photo taken through binoculars shows a grizzly digging vigorously in a rocky meadow.
You know, at the time I didn't stick around for too long to figure out what it was digging for, but what would a bear up that high be looking for? What kind of things would it be digging for?
Well, he could have been digging some underground roots or tubers, you know, like biscuit root or glacier lily bulbs, or he could have been trying to dig up a hibernating ground squirrel.
Ooh, okay. Yeah. Is there a time when they all start to head off for hibernation, or is that just very individualistic?
It's individualistic. They're facultative hibernators, which means they decide they can choose when they want to hibernate or not.
Okay.
So it has to do with food supply, you know, if they're getting enough to eat or not. Kind of depends on the weather. You know, is it really cold and snowy, or is it warm and sunny?
Shot of mama grizzly with three cubs foraging in snowy conditions, then shot of adult grizzly eating on a sunny day, captioned footage courtesy of Bob Chinn.
Right.
You know, that factors into it too.
Okay.
But typically, pregnant females go into the den first. So usually around the end of October is when they'll start looking for a den site. The adult males go in last. Mm. Sometimes we have adult males that'll stay out into January sometimes.
Oh, wow.
So, but yeah, the grizzly bears will typically go up way up high elevation sites to dig their dens.
Okay.
You know, like way up on these ridgetops up here.
Shot of mama grizzly and two cubs walking up a snowfield in the mountains, captioned footage courtesy Bob Chinn.
Where the black bears tend to den down low, a place like this would be a place you might find a black bear den.
What a difference. And that's always, as far as we know, been the case even before kind of the Western settlers came.
Yeah, the black bears are kind of tied to trees, you know, so they'll den underneath the roots of a tree, or sometimes in these creek bottoms you see these big old cottonwood trees, and they'll actually climb up in the cottonwood tree. If there's a hollow up high, they'll den high up in the tree too.
Yes, I remember seeing that on our webcam.
That's right. Yeah.
Webcam footage of black bear climbing into a large hole in a cottonwood tree.
I bet the grizzly bear is always kind of getting, and when they up high, what kind of den are they making? Is it in rock?
Typically they dig a den, so they need soil.
Okay.
They'll excavate it, and sometimes you can spot them because all that dirt that they dig out will be piled up in front of the den entrance.
Photo of researchers sitting on top of a large bear den hole in a rocky area with lots of vegetation.
We call it the porch.
Yes, the porch.
Sometimes they use rock caves, but that's more the exception than the rule. I think because they tend to be colder.
Yeah.
You know, a burrow in the ground can be quite cozy, and they'll line it with bear grass.
Photo of a mountain slope covered with plants that have tufts of luxurious grass at the base and a tall white flower on a stalk.
And other materials to make it nice and warm.
Yep.
Okay.
And they can be quite large. I went into a den once that had been occupied by a sow with three 2-year-olds.
Whoa!
So that's a lot of bear packed into a hole in the ground.
And that's a lot of digging.
Yep. Yeah, I could sit in there upright, cross-legged, and the remote for the TV was there, so I could flip channel flip.
Perfect. Man, that sounds like a great place to hide out all winter. Yeah. Nice. John, we have learned so much about bears today. Grizzly bears, black bears, where they live, what they do, their behaviors. Just amazing critters, and there's so much to know about them. And so I'm thanking so much for you being here today and all of you for joining us. This has been a great science
video.
And that's a wrap, folks, for science videos this year. We will see you next spring and summer for another amazing series talking with our researchers, scientists, resource managers, and naturalists here in the park. So thanks for joining us this year. Thanks, John. Happy Glacier Science Day. Bye.
Caption reads, bear safety is important any time of year, and displays link to John's bear safety video.